Blessed Sabbath and good morning to each one of you. God is very good, isn't he? Today we're talking about becoming one with God. There's going to come a time where we're either going to be in or out. A lot of people are sort of halfway between now. We're a little in, sometimes we're a little out. Maybe we're a lot in, but a little out. But I think of something that Ellen White said. She said, you know, to be not wholly saved is to be wholly lost. Isn't that right? And so the only way that we're going to get in is to become like God in character, to become one with Him. And the Bible speaks a lot about this. Last night I was preparing a sermon, which was another sermon than this one, and things just weren't falling into place. And so I'm just asking, Lord, you know, what's wrong here? Because obviously something's not falling into place. This isn't what the people need today. And my mind was drawn to a particular statement I saw in my research. I found this statement and said, boy, that's a really, really good statement. And I got to looking at it, and the more I got to looking at it, the better I thought it was. And in preparing this and in doing this, it helped me to also grasp a little better, and I hope for you today too, the concept of going beyond surface reading. Do you know what I mean when I say surface reading? We can just read something through very quick just to get read through, but do we really think and dwell upon it? Because I know there's a statement of Ellen White. She says, you know, that one single verse thought upon, dwelt upon, would do us more value than many verses read quickly. Right? So I have a statement for you, and that statement is right here. It's from the youth instructor of October 28, 1897. And it says this, listen carefully, please, and read with me if you have the slide available. God has made every provision whereby our thoughts may become purified, elevated, refined, and ennobled. He has not only promised to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, but He has made an actual provision for the supply of the grace which will lift our thoughts toward Him and enable us to appreciate His holiness. We may realize that we are Christ's possession and that we are to manifest His character to the world. Prepared by heavenly grace, we become clothed with the righteousness of Christ in the wedding garment and are fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. We become one with Christ, partakers of the divine nature, purified, refined, elevated, and acknowledged to be the children of God, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you, that statement says a lot.
Amen.
It really says a lot. And as I thought about it, I broke it up into about five sections. So the first section is the first sentence. God has made every provision whereby our thoughts may become purified, elevated, refined, and ennobled. That's part one. Part two then, He has not only promised to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, but He has made an actual provision for the grace, or for the supply of the grace that will lift our thoughts toward Him and enable us to appreciate His holiness. And then she says, we may realize that we are Christ's possession and that we are to manifest His character to the world. Number three. Number four, prepared by heavenly grace, we become clothed with the righteousness of Christ in the wedding garment and are fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. And then the last one, we become one with Christ, partakers of the divine nature, purified, refined, elevated, and acknowledged to be the children of God, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. Each one, of course, is a sentence, and it does conveniently break that way, but not only grammatically, but in thought. These are the five thoughts that make up the whole part. And so what I want to do, I want to look at each one of these five parts today. So we have a five-part sermon, okay? And we're going to try to look beyond the surface of these and really find out what they're meaning. What is it saying to us? Because I think there is a greatly important spiritual lesson. And this is a lesson that is outlined from the spirit of prophecy, but it's a very biblically based idea, and you'll see that as we look at many Bible texts today. Okay? Now, as I was preparing my remarks for today, on my computer screen I had my writing program over here where I'm putting my notes in. And then what I did, I posted a little post-it note on my computer. It's an electronic post-it note that I could keep on top all the time. It stayed on top all the time. With this broken up in these five parts like this, because as I was going through this, it was important for me to keep a visual and mental awareness of the section I was working on and in light of the whole context as well. Now, I really can't easily do that here and make it big enough for you to see, but what we're going to do is we're going to try to post things in a way that will help you to be able to see the context of it as well. But the first part of it here says, God has made every provision whereby our thoughts may become purified, elevated, refined, and ennobled. And you say, well, those are all about the same thing, aren't they? But there are differences, and Ellen White was very particular and very careful in the way that she chose some words here, I believe. But let's think about the first part of this. God has made every provision for these thoughts to be. That tells me something. It tells me that I'm not responsible to have to originate the ability to do this. God is. And God's willing to make that provision or to provide for us. To make provision, in fact, means that He has provided for or supplied the need. But what has He made provision for? He's made provision for four different aspects here about our thoughts. And the first thing is that they become purified. But what is the name, what is the word purified, or coming from pure, to purify, purified? It says they're purified, but that means purify. I get it. What does that mean? When we purify something, what does it mean?
Make clean.
To make clean? Clean from what?
Defilement.
Okay. Okay. Thinking just in a generic sense first, and then we'll make the application. If you have some gold ore or silver ore, and you want to refine it, you want to get all the impurities out because there's dross in it, there's filth in it, maybe the comparable to the sin in our lives. But it means it's not mixed with other things or adulterated, in this case, with evil. And we're talking about our thoughts. Oh, I heard an interesting so-called fact the other day. You can speak slowly, but you can speak quickly, right? But they say there's only one speed for your thoughts. You can't speed or slow your thoughts down. Thoughts are just at one speed. But friends, no matter what speed they're at, they need to be purified. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians in our Bibles. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And I'm going to read verses 3 through 5. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or fleshly, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." Every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, we live in a world today that is vastly different than the world that our grandparents and our great-grandparents lived in. It's vastly different than the world that James and Ellen White lived in. And their world probably to them was vastly different than the world that George Washington lived in. But we see today, on an exponential rise, influences of a worldly nature bombarding us in a way that no generation has ever saw it before.
Amen.
And the only way that we can keep every thought in obedience to the captivity of Christ is to purify it from all the dross that's in this world trying to gain our attention. We see things, you walk into a store, even a simple store like Walmart, you will see displays. Even beyond the displays, you'll see products. Products that promote sensual, lustful thoughts. Products that provoke thoughts of pride and self-exaltation. You know, if you take this or if you use this, you'll be more glamorous, you'll be more beautiful. You will see things that will promote intemperance. gluttony. And that's just walking into a Walmart. But then you have to hear the music that they're probably playing too. And if you turn a television on, or even a YouTube thing on, you know, you think, I'm going to be selective. I've got 500 channels here on my satellite. I only watch two or three of them. It's hard to avoid these things, but the Bible says that we must try to do this in every way possible. In Romans chapter 13 and verse 14, he says, "But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." He says, don't make a provision to sin. Now, it's easy for me to make an application to someone else. I can tell someone else, for instance, who's smoking. Look, you're trying to quit smoking, right? So what you got to do is, first of all, get all of the cigarettes out of the house. If you leave the cigarettes in the house, just in case, and you're making a provision to fail. We would say that, wouldn't we, to a smoker. But friends, if we have things amongst us, or if we go places where there are things in the environment that can cause us to stumble or to keep impure thoughts or to not have our thoughts purified, then we have to, as Jesus said, pluck the eye out or cut the hand off. Because we'd be better off doing that and to go into heaven maimed than to go into hell whole. So she says our thoughts are to be purified, they are to be elevated. And it will, the pace pick up a little bit, we won't spend all day here. Our thoughts to be elevated. Elevated means to be placed high. High, holy things. If you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. It says that God has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. But friends, he cannot and he will not do that if our thoughts are not elevated. He doesn't want our minds in the gutter. He wants them up high. We are told, for instance, that dwelling upon a love of money can destroy elevated thoughts. Did you know that? There's some counsel, and I put the main thought up here at the top for these statements. So the main thought will be up here that we're dealing with at the time, so we can keep our focus on where we're at. But she's writing about elderly people and sometimes how they become obsessed with holding onto their money or not losing their money or making sure they have enough money. And she says all these fears, referring to their fears about money, she says originate with Satan. He excites the organs which led to slavish fears and jealousies which corrupt nobleness of soul and destroy elevated thoughts and feelings. Such persons are insane upon the subject of money. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 423. Now, it's true, friends. You don't have to have a lot of money to love money. You know, the Bible says love money is the root of all evil, right? But people who are poor think, well, that doesn't affect me because I don't have much. But you can love money. You can want to hold on to your money, whether you're rich or poor. And we know that we've been told that systematic benevolence is a plan God has that helps to starve covetousness to death. Continual giving, she says, starves covetousness to death. Another thing, she says, that can destroy elevated thoughts, it's the kind of music we listen to. Writing to a brother Y, Ellen White noted, "The character of your music was not such as to encourage elevated thoughts or feelings, but rather to denigrate." Now think about this for a minute. We live in a society today when all music is considered to be amoral. By that I mean that there's no moral aspect to music. You can listen to music, it's not good, it's not bad, it's just music, right? And this is one of the reasons that we can have what is called today Christian rock, which is an oxymoron. But because of this idea that music is all moral, you can have bands that play terrible, I mean, music that sounds like it came from Jimi Hendrix or Janis Joplin, and yet it supposedly has Christian words with it, and it's supposed to be okay because of that. But Ellen White here is very specific. She says that there's some music that will demoralize our thoughts, and some music that will help elevate our thoughts. And good hymns. There are bad hymns, friends. There are things called hymns that aren't hymns. But good hymns, and even certain classical music, can elevate your thoughts. Can inspire you to think well. Music is not all moral. It is moral. Yet, and I read a statistic, and I believe the statistic, over 90% of all children born out of wedlock are conceived with satanic music in the background. I mean, you know, they may not call it satanic. We call it rock and roll. We call it jazz or something like that. But this kind of music, it's always in the background whenever these kind of events happen. That's right. Here's another thing she says. Love of the world is one of the leading temptations of youth, and one that our Savior repeatedly warned his disciples against. Parents, however, frequently encourage in their children the desire to seek happiness in gratifying the outward senses and in frequenting scenes of gaiety and frivolous amusements. By teaching them to avoid these things, you prepare them to cherish elevated thoughts, fit them to occupy positions of trust and importance in this life, and to receive the reward of the faithful in the future immortal life. Signs of the Times, December 19th, 1878. And so she's saying here that certain frivolous and gaiety scenes, such as in amusement halls and things, that they prepare our children not to be able to cherish elevated thoughts. So that's something we should try to avoid. And we're all learning, right? We're all learning. But this is important. She says our thoughts are also to be purified, elevated, and refined. Our thoughts are to be refined. And again, to refine is very similar to purify. It means to remove impurities or unwanted elements. But I think of a text in Zechariah. If we could turn to Zechariah 13:9. He says, I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. That says, God says, I'm going to refine my people. In our statement, she says, God has made every provision whereby our thoughts may be refined. God says he's going to refine us. And how does God usually refine his people? Yes, through trials. Absolutely. In the Southern Watchman, February 7th, 1905, affliction, temptation, adversary, and other varied trials are the means by which God refines and sanctifies us. Oh, and we don't like our trials, but you know, that they're there for a reason, aren't they?
That's right.
They're there for a reason. James. James chapter 1, starting in verse 2. He says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. He's saying that when trials and trouble come, he says, let them come, because they're here for a reason. God has given them to us for a refining thing. Well, one more thing, we have to move on because this is only part one. But we probably spent more time here than the other places, so it's okay. Our thoughts are to be ennobled. That means they are to be noble, or of nobility status. That means royalty, friends. You think about that? We are told the thoughts are ennobled by the truth of God. Counsels to Parents and Teachers and Students, page 443. You want to have ennobled thoughts, then you should be dwelling upon the truth of God. That's right. We have another statement here from Testimonies for the Church, volume 4, page 590. While the hands are engaged in the common labor, the mind may be elevated and ennobled by pure and holy thoughts. In other words, as we think about what it says in Philippians chapter 4, in verse 8, he says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. And as we think on these things, it will ennoble our thoughts. We will have thoughts like a king has, should have, because our king, our king is Jesus. God has promised to cleanse us and make provision for grace that our thoughts are toward Him, and we appreciate His holiness. Part two. And the first part of that is that He has promised to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, the first text that comes to our mind is 1 John 1:9. You remember that text? But turn to that text and look at it, because I want you to notice something you maybe didn't see in it before. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. And again, we're trying to get a little below the surface, right? We're trying to see how deep our aqua lung can take us in this ocean of Bible truth here. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Do you see something in that verse you didn't see before?
No. Are you thinking of we confess our sins?
It is the word our. O-U-R.
It's not in here.
It's an italicized word.
Right.
If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I have a comment on this that I found that I thought was very interesting. And this comes from something called the Bible Knowledge Commentary. And on this verse, and it notes that R is not in the Greek text. And that's true, and the King James writers, translators show that. The phrase tas hamartias contains only an article and noun, and it is conceivable that the article is the type which grammaticians call the article of previous reference. If so, there is a subtle contrast between the expression our sins and the all unrighteousness which follows it. John's thought might be paraphrased. If we confess our sins, He will forgive the sins we confess, and moreover, will even cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Naturally, only God knows at any moment the full extent of a person's unrighteousness. Each Christian, however, is responsible to acknowledge, and that's the meaning of confess, homologo men. He makes references to 1 John 2:23 and 1 John 4:3. It says, whatever the light makes him aware of, and when he does so, a complete and perfect cleansing is granted. Let me just pause before we go to the next part. You today probably don't know every sin you've ever committed.
Right.
You can only confess the sins that you know of. But what about the sins that I haven't got to my mind yet? The text is telling us that we confess what we know, and then God cleanses us from all unrighteousness beyond that. Isn't that beautiful? That God will do that? Now, as the text, as this reference says, God may bring things to your knowledge and you're responsible for it then. Of course you are. But until that's brought to your mind, your heart is at one with God. What more does God want? He wants your heart. This reference goes on to say, moreover, it is comforting to learn that the forgiveness which is promised here is both absolutely assured because God is faithful and also is in no way contrary to His holiness. He is just. The word used here for just, dikaios, is the same word which is applied as a title to Christ in 2:1. That's 1 John 2:1, where it is translated the righteous one. Dikaios is also used of God, either the Father or the Son, in 2:29 and 3:7. Obviously, God is just or righteous when He forgives the believing sinner because of the atoning sacrifice which the Lord Jesus has made, see 2:2. As is already evident from 1:7, a Christian's fellowship with God is inseparably connected with the effectiveness of the blood which Jesus shed for him. It's a good thought. And it helps us to understand what it means that He has promised to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He has promised to supply grace to lift our thoughts. Here's the whole statement that we're looking at right now. He has not only promised to cleanse us, but He has promised an actual provision for the supply of grace that will lift us up. In Philippians chapter 4, And verse 19, he says, but my God shall supply all your needs, or all your need, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now, grace we consider to be unmerited favor, right? It's something that we can't get. It's something that we need. But the promise is that he's going to supply all of our need through Christ, including the need of our grace. And so when he says, for instance, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, does he supply the ability for the and the grace for that mind to be in us? He sure does. And he gives us the provision, the motivational provision for doing this. You know, the Bible says in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 9, I believe, it says that in this was manifested the love of God, and that he gave his only begotten Son for us. And that's how we know how much he loves us. That he gave his Son for us, and he is supplying all of our needs through his Son, Jesus Christ, that he has gave for us. And he's enabling us then, and this is an interesting thought, he's enabling us to appreciate not just holiness, his holiness. Oh, I can't do that. I can't do that. Wait a minute. The reference says, and enable us, he has provided grace that will lift our thoughts toward him, and as our thoughts are lifted up toward him, they will enable us to appreciate his holiness. Oh, I can't do that. I can't do that. Can you do that? Wait a minute. Let's read it again. And enable us to appreciate his holiness. Is it true or not?
It's true.
It's true! I can do that. Not in myself. Not in my own self in any way. But somehow, friends, I think this is one of the greatest promises I've ever read. It's so huge. How can I ever come to learn to appreciate his holiness? Now, she didn't put the word fully in there. I'm thankful for that. That might have been a little more challenging to me. But there is, at least on a basic level, the ability God has put within us, through his grace, to appreciate his holiness. God is so much greater than we are. And yet he has promised to help feeble us to somehow understand the full worth of his holiness. Because the word appreciate, it means to gain a full worth, or to recognize the full worth of something, and to be grateful for and to understand it. In Psalms 96, verse 9, he says, O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. But you can't do that if you don't understand the beauty of holiness, can you? If you don't appreciate it. But he's told us that we indeed can do this. We're told also in this original statement we started in the third part, part three now, we may realize that we are Christ's possession and that we are to manifest his character to the world. This really is probably, I think, in some respects, one of the hardest things for Seventh-day Adventists, because so many people have had a misunderstanding of the investigative judgment and what it really means and what happens in it. And many Adventists walk around with a fear that, oh, my name may come up right now, and if I do anything wrong, you know, like wrong right now, I'm out forever. And that really isn't the way the investigative judgment works, especially for those who are living. But the Bible says that we may know that we have eternal life. Do you believe that? I just made a statement. The Bible says we may know we have eternal life. And if the Bible says it, then I must believe it. Is that right? But if I don't know, that means maybe I don't really have it. You know. 1 John chapter 5, going back to 1 John again. Verse 10. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. Now I want to ask you a question. Do you believe on the Son of God today?
Yes.
We all know who Jesus is. We know Jesus as the Son of God. The congregation I'm talking to today, we understand who Jesus is. He's the Son of God. So we all say, yes, we understand that. Okay? Verse 11, and this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. If John wanted to write it more simply, could he? How could he? Verse 13, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Now, of course, we all know the devils believe and tremble. They don't have saving faith. But if you have saving faith, the kind of faith the Bible speaks about here, then you know that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You know? I have a relationship with Sister Ann. She's like a second mother to me. And I know that there's times that she's been upset with me, just like a good mother gets upset with a son for whatever. But I know that at the end of the day, or maybe at the end of the week, but one time it was at the end of a month, everything's going to eventually be okay. Everything will be okay. Because I have a relationship with her. And if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, friends, you know that everything's going to be okay, provided you maintain and keep that relationship with Him. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. You know the text. For you're all the children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. You know, Galatians 3:26. You know, Jesus said, He told Nicodemus, He says, in John 3:3, He says, ye must be what?
Born again.
You must be born again. In other words, we can be born into the family of God. And that's what we need to do. We need to be born into the family of God. Give me just a second. Okay, I'll come back to that in a minute. And if you're born in the family of God, then you can have this confidence. You can realize that you really are Christ's possession. He died for you. He's bought you. He's redeemed you. And you can come boldly to the throne of grace. Hebrews 4:16. There's a text in Hebrews 12, though. And this text might haunt you. Hebrews 12:8. He says, but if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. We don't want to be away from home. We want to be in our homes. We want our children to be safe and secure in their homes. And God wants us to be safe and secure in His heavenly family. And so at times He chastises us. At times He sends trials to us. He says, but if I didn't do this, you would be as bastards. You would be as people who were illegitimate. But because you are my children, because I accept you, I do this for you. When I was 16, maybe 17, I was told by my parents to drive one of our cars to town to the bus station and pick up my brother who was coming in from school for the weekend. And I was asleep. I was actually asleep. They woke me up because it was in the evening. And it wasn't that late, but I was tired and I'd already went to bed. And I was sleepy. And I just wasn't awake. I ended up having an accident. I wasn't drinking. I wasn't doing foolish things. I wasn't speeding. I just had an accident. And probably to a great degree because I was just not on the top of my game. But that night, my dad ordered me out of the house. He kicked me out of the house for having an accident with the car. And I didn't know if I was a son or I was a bastard for a while. I tell you, it's a terrible feeling. The worst week of my life, when I was a youth, was that week away from home. Not knowing if I would ever be able to allow to go home again. But friends, our Heavenly Father, He's not like that. He's merciful. And He's good. And He's like the man in the story that Jesus told about the prodigal son. He is the father who is going down the road already looking for you, wanting to meet you. Because He wants you to be His son. He doesn't want you to be some illegitimate. But there is a truth, friends, and we need to understand this. That if we fail to live as sons and daughters, if we refuse the Father's fatherhood, if we refuse Jesus Christ as being our elder brother, there will be a time that Christ will and must separate us from the flock forever. May that never happen to us. He says that we may realize that we are Christ's possession, that we are to manifest His character to the world. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 1, 2 Corinthians 3, 1, Paul says, "Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you?" Verse 2, "Ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ," you are the letter of Christ, "ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart." People watch you. Don't think for a minute that they don't. They watch you every step you take. And the more you come close to Christ, I promise you, the more scrutiny and the closer they're going to look at you, because Satan wants them to find something wrong. But God wants them to find something good in you. And has He made provision for them to find something good in us? He has. And we should not deny the grace of God. He's done this. In Acts chapter 4, verse 13. I like this text. Acts 4:13. "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. And they took knowledge of them that they, though they were ignorant, though they were unlearned, they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus." What had brought about this change among these unlearned and ignorant men? They had been with Jesus. And they were now manifesting the character of Jesus. Even in boldness, they were manifesting the character of Jesus. Now, how do we do this? Well, it may not be by trying to feed 5,000 with breadcrumbs. Unless God tells you to do it, that's okay. But rather, we do this by spending time with Jesus. And then the truth of 2 Corinthians 3:18 becomes true in you. Do you remember what it says in 2 Corinthians 3:18? That by beholding we become changed as we look into a glass, beholding the glory of the Lord, are changed in the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. And that's how that happens in our lives. And then we are told that we are to be prepared by heavenly grace. We become clothed with the righteousness of Christ in the wedding garment and are fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. So there you have those three great items, those three great thoughts. The righteousness of Christ, the wedding supper, and the wedding garment, sorry, and the marriage supper. It says that we are to be prepared by what kind of grace? Heavenly grace. And I like this statement from Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers on page 508. And it says this, "Divine grace." What kind of grace?
Divine.
Would you say it's about the same thing as heavenly? Close enough for today. "Divine grace is needed at the beginning, divine grace at every step of advance, and divine grace alone can complete the work." We need that divine grace, but He has promised to give it to us, to clothe us with the righteousness of not our own selves, because our own righteousness is as filthy rags, but with the righteousness of Christ. In Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, verses 25 and 26. Well, I'll read verse 24 also. "Being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus." In Isaiah 61, in verse 10, he says, "He has clothed me with His garment of righteousness." That's what He does for us. In Zechariah 3, you have the illustration there of Joshua and how he was clothed in filthy garments. But they took away the filthy garments and then they clothed him with the righteousness of Jesus. And that's what Jesus wants to do for us. But before he puts on the garment of righteousness, before we put on that beautiful wedding garment, he has to strip us of our filthiness, you see. And he can do that. In the book, The Faith I Live By, and this is actually, I believe, originally from Series B, number 2, but it's very nicely laid out here. Faith I Live By, page 111. Ellen White asks the question, what is justification by faith? Let's make this easy. It is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which it is not in his power to do for himself. When men see their own nothingness, they are prepared to be clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And so that is the prerequisite, that we must see our own nothingness. And she says then that we are to be fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. Now Jesus taught a parable about a wedding garment and a supper in Matthew 22. We won't take time to read it now, but if you want to make reference to it, you can go back there. But in that story, the person who didn't have the wedding garment on, they didn't get to attend the supper. The only way you get to the supper is to have the wedding garment on. Okay? But the good news is, and this statement says, prepared by heavenly grace, we become clothed with the righteousness of Christ in the wedding garment and are fitted to sit down at the marriage seat. It says the righteous are going to be fitted. Do you believe that? No, that can't happen. Can it? Wait a minute. It says, and are fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. But I can't be fit. I've been so filthy all my life. I've done wrong. Can't be me. Wait a minute. And are fitted to sit down at the marriage supper. You mean, friends, that it doesn't matter what I think, it only matters what the inspiration says? Isn't that right? It doesn't matter what you think. You may think that you're unworthy. You may feel you're unworthy. Well, that's fine. You are unworthy. Don't worry about that. The point is that Jesus has promised to help you.
That's right.
See? And he's promised to fit you. And in Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. And we will start reading in verse 7 through 9. Revelation 19, 7 through 9. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself what?
Ready.
She is ready, because she has the wedding garment on, friends. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And of course, the only righteousness that we have is the righteousness of
Christ.
And he said unto me, write, blessed are they which are called into the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, these are true sayings of God. These are the true sayings of God. And so God has promised to do this, and I believe that he'll fulfill it. And we need to go on. We are to be one with Christ, partakers of the divine nature, purified, refined, elevated, and acknowledged to be the children of God, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. And we'll come to that statement in just a minute. But let's look at 1 Corinthians 6:17 first. 1 Corinthians 6:17. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Is one spirit. Join the Lord as one spirit. Jesus said in John chapter 15, verse 4, that we have to abide in him. And in 2 Peter 1:3, it says, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and what? Virtue. And so we have the ability to partake of the divine nature through the great and exceeding precious promises of God. And then we have this statement that I think is so good from the Desire of Ages, page 388. She says, Christ became one flesh with us in order that we might become one spirit with him. Remember 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17? He that is joined in the Lord is one spirit. It is by virtue of this union that we are to come forth from the grave, not merely as a manifestation of the power of Christ, but because through faith, his life has become ours. Those who see Christ in his true character and receive him into the heart have everlasting life. It is through the Spirit that Christ dwells in us, and the Spirit of God received into the heart by faith is the beginning of life eternal. Ellen White is telling us, friends, that when Jesus comes back, and in that great first resurrection, it's not going to be any great miracle happening at that time, because the miracle has already occurred.
Amen.
That eternal life is already abiding. And I think it's interesting. You notice what she says here, going back again to part 5 statement, that as we become partakers of the divine nature, we are purified, refined, elevated. Did you see those words somewhere before? They were in the very first part about our thoughts. And because you see, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Right? That's right. And it says they are acknowledged to be the children of God. God is saying, these are mine. These are mine. In Spiritual Gifts, volume 2 and page 2, she says the 144,000 were all sealed and perfectly united. On their foreheads was written, God, New Jerusalem, and a glorious star containing Jesus' new name. At our happy holy state, the wicked were enraged and would rush violently up to lay hands on us to thrust us into prison, when we would stretch forth the hand in the name of the Lord, and the wicked would fall helpless to the ground. Then it was that the synagogue of Satan knew that God had loved us, and they worshipped at our feet. Even the synagogue of Satan will know that you are God's. And you will be heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Now, an heir is one who has a legal right. My mother died a couple years ago. I have one brother. We were both heirs. And in fact, we were joint heirs. We were even heirs. That meant that whatever was in the property, under theory at least, it was supposed to be split equally, right? And you know, to think that Jesus is heir of all heaven and earth, and we become heirs with him, joint heirs with Christ. Friends, I say this humbly, and I say this without anything to be disparaging toward the angels or any other heavenly intelligences. But to our knowledge, that promise is not for anyone else but us. The angels won't even be joint heirs with Christ in the same way that we will be. And something that's almost as equally marvelous is they won't be jealous either. They'll be happy and glad. Those of us who have sinned and understood the degradation of what sin does, we will be brought to a place that even the angels can't be brought to in our relationship with God in Christ. We will be heirs, and of course Ellen White's quoting here or making reference to Romans 8, 16 and 17, where the Bible says that we indeed are heirs and joint heirs of God through Christ. And so through the provisions of God, through God's provisions, we are to bring every thought into obedience and under captivity so that those thoughts can be elevated, so that those thoughts can be refined, they can be purified and ennobled. And that through the provision of his cleansing and supply of grace, to whereby we may know that we are his, that we can have the righteousness of Christ, we will wear the wedding garment, and we will finally sit down at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we will become joint heirs with Christ in the kingdom of God. All of that was in one little paragraph. How many paragraphs did you read this last week? I bet more than one. Well, I hope more than one. I hope you read something this last week. But what I'm saying is, friends, we need to meditate and dwell upon the Word of God. And this takes time, friends. You can't do it in a moment. We need to do this, friends. This is important. And God, he's opening all heaven up to you, that you can be a joint heir with Christ if you will simply receive of his grace so that your thoughts can be ennobled and elevated and refined and purified. And you'll have the assurance that you, you know, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.